The following is a free for download audiobook from the website krishnapath.org. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 5, Part 1, Chapter 2, The Activities of Maharaj Agnidra. In this chapter, the character of Maharaj Agnidra is described. When Maharaj Priyavrata went off for spiritual realization, his son Agnidra became the ruler of Jambudvip, in accordance with Maharaj Priyavrata's instructions, and maintained its residence with the same affection a father feels for his sons. Once Maharaj Agnidra desired to have a son, and therefore he entered a cave of Mandara Mountain to practice austerity. Understanding his desire, Lord Brahma sent a celestial girl named Purvachiti to Agnidra's hermitage. After dressing herself very attractively, she presented herself before him with various feminine movements, and Agnidra was naturally attracted to her. The girl's actions, expressions, smile, sweet words, and moving eyes were fascinating to him. Agnidra was expert in flattery. Thus, he attracted the celestial girl, who was pleased to accept him as her husband because of his mellifluous words. She enjoyed royal happiness with Agnidra for many years before returning to her abode in the heavenly planets. In her womb, Agnidra begot 9 sons: Nabi, Kimpurusha, Harivarsha, Ilavrita, Ramyaka, Hiranmaya, Kuru, Bhadrashva, and Ketumala. He gave them 9 islands with names corresponding to theirs. Agnidra, however, his senses unsatisfied, was always thinking of his celestial wife, and therefore in his next life he was born in her celestial planet. After the death of Agnidra, his 9 sons married 9 daughters of Meru named Merudevi, Pratirupa, Agra-Dhamaristri, Lata, Ramya, Syama, Nari, Bhadra, and Devaviti. Text 1. Sri Shukadeva Goswami continued, after his father, Maharaj Priyavrata, departed to follow the path of spiritual life by undergoing austerities, King Agnidra completely obeyed his order. Strictly observing the principles of religion, he gave full protection to the inhabitants of Jambudvip as if they were his own begotten sons. Purport. In following the instruction of his father, Maharaj Priyavrata, Maharaj Agnidra ruled the inhabitants of Jambudvip according to religious principles. These principles are exactly contrary to the modern principles of faithlessness. As clearly stated here, the king protected the citizens the way a father protects his begotten children. How he ruled the citizens is also described here. Dharma Vekshamana, strictly according to religious principles. It is the duty of the executive head of state to see that the citizens strictly follow religious principles. The Vedic religious principles begin with Varnashram Dharma, the duties of the 4 Varnas and 4 Ashrams. Dharma refers to principles given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The first principle of Dharma, or religion, is to observe the duties of the 4 orders as enjoined by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. According to people's qualities and activities, society should be divided into Brahmanas, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and Shudras, and then again into Brahmacharis, Grihasthas, Vanaprasthas, and Sannyasis. These are religious principles, and it is the duty of the head of state to see his citizens strictly follow them. He should not merely act officially, he should be like a father who is always a well-wisher of his sons. Such a father strictly observes whether his sons are performing their duties, and sometimes he also punishes them. Just contrary to the principles mentioned here, the presidents and chief executives in the age of Kali are simply tax collectors who do not care whether religious principles are observed. Indeed, the chief executives of the present day introduce all kinds of sinful activity, especially illicit sex, intoxication, animal killing, and gambling. These sinful activities are now very prominently manifested in India. Although 100 years ago, these four principles of sinful life were strictly prohibited in the families of India, they have now been introduced into every Indian family, and therefore they cannot follow religious principles. In contrast to the principles of the kings of old, the modern state is concerned only with propaganda for levying taxes and is no longer responsible for the spiritual welfare of the citizens. The state is now callous to religious principles. Srimad Bhagavatam predicts that in Kali Yuga, the government will be entrusted with Dasya Dharma, which means, or Dasyu Dharma, which means the occupational duty of rogues and thieves. Modern heads of state are rogues and thieves who plunder the citizens instead of giving them protection. Rogues and thieves plunder without regard for law, but in this age of Kali, as stated in Srimad Bhagavatam, the lawmakers themselves plunder them citizens. The next prediction to be fulfilled, which is already coming to pass, is that because of the sinful activities of the citizens and the government, rain will become increasingly scarce. Gradually, there will be complete drought and no production of food grains. People will be reduced to eating flesh and seeds, and many good, spiritually inclined people will have to forsake their homes because they will be too harassed by drought, taxation, and famine. The Krishna consciousness movement is the only hope to save the world from such devastation. It is the most scientific and authorized movement for the actual welfare of the whole human society. Text 2. Desiring to get a perfect son and become an inhabitant of Prithvi Loka, Maharaj Agnidra once worshipped Lord Brahma, the master of those in charge of material creation. He went to a valley of Mandara Hill, where the damsels of the heavenly planets come down to stroll. There he collected garden flowers and other necessary paraphernalia, and then engaged in severe austerities and worship. Purport. The king became Prithvi Loka Kama, desirous of being transferred to the planet named Prithvi Loka. Prithvi Loka is mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, Yanti Deva Vrata Devan Prithrin Yanti Prithvi Vrata. To go to this planet, one needs very good sons who can make offerings to Lord Vishnu and then offer the remnants to their forefathers. The purpose of the Shraddha ceremony is to please the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, so that after pleasing him, one may offer prasad to one's forefathers and in this way make them happy. The inhabitants of Prithvi Loka are generally men of the Karma Kandiya or fruit of activities category who have been transferred there because of their pious activities. They can stay there as long as their descendants offer them Vishnu prasad. Everyone in the heavenly planets such as Prithvi Loka, however, must return to earth after exhausting the effects of his pious acts. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita 9.21, Sine punye martilokam bishanti. Persons who perform pious acts are transferred to higher planets, but when the effects of their pious acts are over, they are again transferred to earth. Since Maharaj Priyavrata was a great devotee, how could he have begotten a son who desired to be transferred to Prithvi Loka? Lord Krishna says, Prithvi Nyanti Prithvi Vrata. Persons who desire to go to Prithvi Loka are transferred there. Similarly, Yanti Madhya Jivnopimam, persons who desire to be transferred to the spiritual planets, Vaikuntha Lokas, can also go there. Since Maharaj Agnidra was the son of a Vaishnava, he should have desired to be transferred to the spiritual world, Vaikuntha Loka. Why then did he desire to be transferred to Prithvi Loka? In answer to this, Goswami Giridhar, one of the Bhagavatam commentators, remarked that Agnidra was born when Maharaj Priyavrata was infatuated by lusty desires. This may be accepted as a fact because sons are begotten with different mentalities according to the time of their conception. According to the Vedic system, therefore, before a child is conceived, the Garbhadhan Samskar is performed. This ceremony holds the mentality of the father in such a way that when he plants his seed in the womb of his wife, he will beget a child whose mind will be completely saturated with a devotional attitude. At the present moment, however, there are no such Garbhadham Samskars, and therefore people generally have a lusty attitude when they beget children. Especially in this age of Kali, there are no Garbhadham ceremonies. Everyone enjoys sex with his wife like a cat or dog. Therefore, according to Shastra conjunctions, almost all the people of this age belong to the Shudra category. Of course, although Maharaj Agnidra had a desire to be transferred to Prithviloka, this does not mean that his mentality was that of a Shudra. He was a Kshatriya. Maharaj Agnidra desired to be transferred to Prithviloka, and therefore he needed a wife, because anyone desiring to be transferred to Prithviloka must leave behind a good son to offer yearly pinda or prasad from Lord Vishnu. To have a good son, Maharaj Agnidra wanted a wife from a family of demigods. Therefore, he went to Mandara Hill, where the women of the demigods generally come to worship Lord Brahma. In Bhagavatam 4.12, it is said, Kankshanta Karmanam Siddhim Yajanta Iha Devata. Materialists who want quick results in this material world worship demigods. This is confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam. Shri Aishvarya Prajesva. Those who desire beautiful wives, substantial wealth, and many sons worship the demigods, but an intelligent devotee, instead of being entangled by the happiness of this material world in the form of a beautiful wife, material opulence, and children, desires to be immediately transferred back home, back to Godhead. Thus, he worships the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Vishnu. Text 3. Understanding King Agnidra's desire, the first and most powerful created being in this universe, Lord Brahma, selected the best of the dancing girls in his assembly, whose name was Purvachiti, and sent her to the king. Purport. In this verse, the words Bhagavan Adi Purusha are significant. Bhagavan Adi Purusha is Lord Krishna, Govindam Adi Purusham Tamham Jami. Lord Krishna is the original person. In Bhagavad Gita, he is also addressed by Arjuna as Purusham Adyam, the original person, and he is called Bhagavan. In this verse, however, we see that Lord Brahma is described as Bhagavan Adi Purusha. The reason he is called Bhagavan is that he fully represents the Supreme Personality of Godhead and is the firstborn creature in this universe. Lord Brahma could understand Maharaj Agnidra's desire because he is as powerful as Lord Vishnu. As Lord Vishnu, situated as Paramatma, can understand the desire of the living entity, so Lord Brahma can also understand the living entity's desire, for Vishnu, as a via medium, informs him. As stated in Srimad Bhagavatam 1.1.1, Teni Brahma Hrida Ya Adikaviye. Lord Vishnu informs Lord Brahma of everything from within his heart. Because Maharaj Agnidra specifically worshipped Lord Brahma was pleased, and he sent Purvachiti, the Apsara, to satisfy him. Text 4. The Apsara sent by Lord Brahma began strolling in a beautiful park near the place where the king was meditating and worshipping. The park was beautiful because of its dense green foliage and golden creepers. There were pairs of varied birds, such as peacocks, and in a lake there were ducks and swans, all vibrating very sweet sounds. As the park was magnificently beautiful because of the foliage, the clear water, the lotus flowers, and the sweet singing of various kinds of birds. Text 5. As Purvachiti passed by on the road in a very beautiful style and a mood of her own, the pleasing ornaments of her ankles tinkled with her every step. Although Prince Agnidra was controlling his senses, practicing yoga with half-open eyes, he could see her with his lotus-like eyes, and when he heard the sweet tinkling of her bangles, he opened his eyes slightly more, and he could see that she was just nearby. Purport. It is said that yogis always think of the Supreme Personality of Godhead within their hearts. Dhyanavastita Tad Gatena Manasa Pashyanti Yam Yogina. Srimad Bhagavatam 12.13.1. The Supreme Personality of Godhead is always observed by yogis who practice controlling the venomous senses. As recommended in Bhagavad Gita, yogis should practice Shamprakshya Nashikagram, keeping their eyes half open. If the eyes are closed completely, there will be a tendency to sleep. So-called yogis sometimes practice a fashionable form of yoga, by closing their eyes and meditating, but we have actually seen that so-called yogis sleeping and snoring while meditating. This is not the practice of yoga. To actually practice yoga, one should keep his eyes half open and gaze at the tip of his nose. Although Agnidra, the son of Priyavrata, was practicing mystic yoga and trying to control his senses, the tinkling sound of Purvachiti's ankle bells disturbed his practice. Yoga Indriya Samyama, an actual yoga practice, means controlling the senses. One must practice mystic yoga to control the senses, but the sense control of a devotee who fully engages in the service of the Lord with his purified senses, Hrishikena Hrishikesha Sevanam, can never be disturbed. Srila Prabodhananda Saraswati therefore stated, Durdan Tendriya Kala Sarpa Patali Proktata Damstrayate, Chaitanya Chandamrita 5. The practice of yoga is undoubtedly good because it controls the senses, which are like venomous serpents. When one engages in devotional service, however, completely employing the activities of the senses in the service of the Lord, the venomous quality of the senses is completely nullified. It is explained that a serpent is to be feared because of its poisonous fangs, but if those fangs are broken, the serpent, although it seems fearsome, is not at all dangerous. Devotees, therefore, may see hundreds and thousands of beautiful women with fascinating bodily movements and gestures, but not be allured, whereas such women would make ordinary yogis fall. Even the advanced yogi Vishwamitra broke his mystic practice to unite with Menaka and begot a child known as Sakuntala. The practice of mystic yoga, therefore, is not sufficiently strong to control the senses. Another example is Prince Agnidra, whose attention was drawn to the movements of Purvachiti, the Apsara, simply because he heard the tinkling of her ankle bells. In the same way that Vishwamitra Muni was attracted by the tinkling bangles of Menaka, Prince Agnidra, upon hearing the tinkling bangles of Purvachiti, immediately opened his eyes to see her beautiful movements as she walked. The prince was also very handsome. As described herein, his eyes were just like the buds of a lotus flower. As he opened his lotus-like eyes, he could immediately see that the Apsara was present by his side. Text 6. Like a honeybee, the Apsara smelled the beautiful and attractive flowers. She could attract the minds and vision of both humans and demigods by her playful movements, her shyness and humility, her glances at the very pleasing sound that poured from her mouth as she spoke, and the motion of her limbs. By all these qualities, she opened for Cupid, who bears an arrow of flowers, a path of oral reception into the minds of men. When she spoke, nectar seemed to flow from her mouth. As she breathed, the bees, mad for the taste of her breath, tried to hover about her beautiful lotus-like eyes. Disturbed by the bees, she tried to move hastily, but as she raised her feet to walk quickly, her hair, the belt on her hips, and her breasts, which were just like water jugs, also moved in a way that made her extremely beautiful and attractive. Indeed, she seemed to be making a pair for the entrance of Cupid, who is most powerful. Therefore, the prince, completely subdued by seeing her, spoke to her as follows. Purport. How a beautiful woman's movements and gestures, her hair and the structure of her breasts, hips, and other bodily features attract the minds of not only of men but of demigods also is very finely described in this statement. The words Dvija and Manuja specifically emphasize that the attraction of feminine gestures is powerful everywhere within this material world, both on this planet and in the higher planetary systems. It is said that the standard of living in the higher planetary systems is thousands and thousands of times higher than the standard of living on this planet. Therefore, the beautiful bodily features of the women there are also thousands and thousands of times more attractive than the features of the women on Earth. The Creator has constructed women in such a way that their beautiful voices and movements and their beautiful features of the beautiful features of their hips, their breasts, and the other parts of their bodies attract the members of the opposite sex, both on Earth and on other planets, and awaken their lusty desires. When one is controlled by Cupid or the beauty of women, he becomes stunned like matter, such as stone. Captivated by the material movements of women, he wants to remain in this material world. Thus, one's promotion to the spiritual world is checked simply by seeing the beautiful bodily structure and movements of women. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has therefore warned all devotees to beware of the attraction of beautiful women and materialistic civilization. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu refused to see Pataparudra Maharaj because he was a very opulent person in the material world. Lord Chaitanya said in this connection, Naskin Shanasya Bhagavan Bhagavad Ba Janan Muktasya. Those who are engaged in the devotional service of the Lord, because they are very serious about going back home, back to Godhead, should be very careful to avoid seeing the beautiful gestures of women, and should also avoid seeing persons who are very rich. Naskin Shanasya Bhagavad Bhajan Nan Muktasya Param Param Jiga Mashor Bhava Sugarsya Sandarshanam Vishayinam Yata Yoshitam Cha Ha Hanta Hanta Visha Basanknato Pi Ashado. Quote, alas, for a person who is seriously desiring to cross the material ocean and engage in the transcendental loving service of the Lord without material motives, seeing a materialist engaged in sense gratification or seeing a woman who is similarly interested is more abominable than drinking poison willingly. Chaitanya Charitamrita, Madhya 11.8. One who is serious about going back home, back to Godhead, should not contemplate the attractive features of women and the opulence of rich men. Such contemplation will check one's advancement in spiritual life. Once a devotee is fixed in Krishna consciousness, however, these attractions will not agitate his mind. Text 7. The prince mistakenly addressed the Apsara. O best of saintly persons, who are you? Why are you on this hill, and what do you want to do? Are you one of the illusory potencies of the Supreme Personality of Godhead? You seem to be carrying two bows without strings. What is the reason you carry these bows? Is it for some purpose for your own or for the sake of a friend? Perhaps you carry them to kill the mad animals in this forest. Purport. While undergoing severe penances in the forest, Agnidra was captivated by the movements of Purvachiti, the girl sent by Lord Brahma. As stated in Bhagavad Gita, Kamastastar Hritagyan, when one becomes lusty, he loses his intelligence. Therefore, Agnidra, having lost his intelligence, could not distinguish whether Purvachiti was male or female. He mistook her for a Muniputra, or the son of a saintly person in the forest, and addressed her as Munivarya. Because of her personal beauty, however, he could not believe her to be a boy. He therefore began studying her features. First, he saw her two eyebrows, which were so expressive that he wondered whether he or she might be the Maya of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The words used in this connection are Bhagavat Deva Devataya. Devata, the demigods, all belong to this material world, whereas Bhagavan, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Krishna, is always beyond this material world and is therefore known as Paradevata. The material world is certainly created by Maya, but it is created under the direction of Paradevata, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. As confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, Maya Dakshena Prakriti Suyatisha Characharam. Maya is not the ultimate authority for the creation of this material world. Maya acts on behalf of Krishna. Purvachiti's eyebrows were so beautiful that Agnidra compared them to bows without strings. He therefore asked her whether they were to be used for her own purpose or for the sake of someone else. Her eyebrows were like bows meant to kill animals in the forest. This material world is like a great forest, and its inhabitants are like forest animals such as deer and tigers meant to be killed. The killers are the eyebrows of beautiful women. K. captivated by the beauty of the fair sex. All the men of the world are killed by bows without strings, but they cannot see how they are killed by Maya. It is a fact, however, that they are being killed, butva butva perliete. By dint of his tapasya, Agnidra could understand how Maya acts under the direction of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The word pramatan is also significant. Pramata refers to one who cannot control his senses. The entire material world is being exploited by people who are pramata, or vimudha. Prahlad Maharaj therefore said, so chetata vimukha chetasa indriyarta maya sukaya baram udva to vimudhan. Quote, they are rotting in material activities for transient material pleasure and spoiling their lives, toiling all day and night simply for sense gratification, with no attachment for love of Godhead. I am simply lamenting for them and devising various plans to deliver them from the clutches of Maya. End quote. Srimad Bhagavatam 7.9.43. Karmis who act very seriously for sense gratification are always referred to in the Shastras by such terms as pramata, vimukha, and vimudha. They are killed by Maya. However, one who is apramata, a sane, sober person, a dhira, knows very well that a human being's primary duty is to render service to the Supreme Person. Maya is always ready to kill those who are pramata with her invisible bows and arrows. Agnidra questioned Purvachiti about this. Text 8. Then Agnidra observed the glancing eyes of Purvachiti and said, my dear friend, you have two very powerful arrows, namely your glancing eyes. Those arrows have feathers like the petals of a lotus flower. Although they have no shafts, they are very beautiful and they have very sharp piercing points. They appear very peaceful, and thus it seems that they will not be shot at anyone. You must be loitering in this forest to shoot those arrows at someone, but I cannot understand whom. My intelligence is dull, and I cannot combat you. Indeed, no one can equal you in prowess, and therefore I pray that your prowess will be for my good fortune. Purport. Agnidra thus began appreciating Purvachiti's powerful glance upon him. He compared her glancing eyes to very sharp arrows. Although her eyes were as beautiful as lotuses, they were simultaneously like shaftless arrows, and Agnitra was therefore afraid of them. He hoped that her glances upon him would be favorable because he was already captivated, and the more captivated he became, the more impossible it would be for him to remain without her. Agnidra therefore prayed to Purvachiti that her glances at him would be auspicious, not futile. In other words, he prayed that she would become his wife. Text 9. Seeing the bumblebees following Purvachiti, Maharaj Agnidra said, my dear Lord, the bumblebees surrounding your body are like disciples surrounding your worshipful self. They are incessantly chanting the mantras of the Samaveda and the Upanishads, thus offering prayers to you. Just as great sages resort to the branches of Vedic literatures, the bumblebees are enjoying the showers of flowers falling from your hair. Text 10. O Brahmana, I can simply hear the tinkling of your ankle bells. Within those bells, titiri birds seem to be chirping among themselves. Although I do not see their forms, I can hear how they are chirping. When I look at your beautiful circular hips, I see there the lovely color of kadamba flowers, and your waist is encircled by a belt of burning cinders. Indeed, you seem to have forgotten to dress yourself. Purport. With lusty desires to see Purvachiti, Agnitra especially gazed upon the girl's attractive hips and waist. When a man looks upon a woman with such lusty desires, he is captivated by her face, her breasts, and her waist. For a woman first attracts a man to fulfill his sexual desires by the beautiful features of her face and by the beautiful slope of her breasts and also by her waist. Purvachita was dressed in fine yellow silk, and therefore her hips looked like kadamba flowers. Because of her belt, her waist seemed to be encircled by burning cinders. She was fully dressed, but Agnidra had become so lusty that he asked, "Why have you come naked?" Text 11. Agnidra then praised Purvachiti's braised breasts. He said, "My dear Brahmana, your waist is very thin, yet with great difficulty you are carrying two horns to which my eyes have become attracted. What is filling those two beautiful horns? You seem to have spread fragrant red powder upon them, powder that is like the rising morning sun. O most fortunate one, I beg to inquire where you have gotten this fragrant powder that is perfuming my ashram, my place of residence." Purport. Agnidra appreciated Purvachiti's raised breasts. After seeing the girl's breasts, he became almost mad. Nonetheless, he could not recognize whether Purvachiti was a boy or a girl, for as a result of his austerity, he saw no distinction between the two. He therefore addressed her with the word Dwija, O Brahmana. Yet why should a Dwija, a Brahmana boy, have horns on his chest? Because the boy's waist was thin, Agnidra thought, he was carrying the horns with great difficulty, and therefore they must be filled with something very valuable. Otherwise, why would he carry them? When a woman's waist is thin and her breasts are full, she looks very attractive. Agnidra, his eyes attracted, contemplated the heavy breasts on the girl's thin body and imagined how her back must sustain them. Agnidra imagined that her raised breasts were two horns she had covered with cloth so that others would not see the valuables within them. Agnidra, however, was very anxious to see them. Therefore, he requested, quote, "Please uncover them so that I can see what you are carrying. Rest assured that I shall not take it away. If you feel an inconvenience in removing the covering, I can help you. I myself can uncover them to see what valuable things those raised horns contain," end quote. He was also surprised to see the red dust of perfumed kumkum spread over her breasts. Nonetheless, still considering Purvachiti a boy, Agnidra addressed her as Subhaga, most fortunate Muni. The boy must have been fortunate, otherwise, how simply by standing there could he perfume Agnidra's entire ashram? Text 12. O best friend, will you kindly show me the place where you reside? I cannot imagine how the residents of that place have gotten such beautiful, wonderful bodily features as your raised breasts, which agitate the mind and eyes of a person like me who sees them. Judging by the sweet speech and kind smiles of those residents, I think that their mouths must contain nectar. Purport. Still bewildered, Agnidra wanted to see the place from which the Brahmana boy had come, where the men had such raised breasts. Such attractive features, he thought, must be due to the severe austerities performed there. Agnidra addressed the girl as Surittama, the best friend, so that she would not refuse to take him there. Not only was Agnidra captivated by the girl's raised breasts, he was also attracted by her sweet speech. Nectar seemed to emanate from her mouth, and therefore he was increasingly surprised. Text 13. My dear friend, what do you eat to maintain your body? Because you are chewing betel, a sweet or pleasant scent is emanating from your mouth. This proves that you always eat the remnants of food offered to Vishnu. Indeed, you must also be an expansion of Lord Vishnu's body. Your face is as beautiful as a pleasing lake. Your jeweled earrings resemble two brilliant sharks of unblinking eyes, with unblinking eyes like those of Vishnu, and your own eyes resemble two restless fish. Simultaneously, therefore, two sharks and two restless fish are swimming in the lake of your face. Besides them, the white rows of your teeth seem like rows of very beautiful swans in the water, and your scattered hair resembled swarms of bumblebees following the beauty of your face. Purport. The devotees of Lord Vishnu are also his expansions. They are called Vibhinamsa. Lord Vishnu is offered all kinds of sacrificial ingredients, and because devotees always eat prasad, the remnants of his food, the scent of the sacrificial ingredients emanates not only from Vishnu, but also from the devotees who eat the remnants of his food or the food of his devotees. Agnidra considered Purvachiti an expansion of Lord Vishnu because of the pleasing scent of her body. Aside from that, because of her jeweled earrings shaped like sharks, because of her scattered hair resembling bumblebees mad after the scent of her body, and because of the white rows of her teeth which resembled swans, Agnidra compared Purvachiti's face to a beautiful lake decorated with lotus flowers, fish, swans, and bumblebees. Text 14. My mind is already restless, and by playing with a ball, moving it about with your lotus-like palm, you are also agitating my eyes. Your curling black hair is now scattered, but you are not attentive to arranging it. Are you not going to arrange it? Like a man attached to women, the most cunning wind is trying to take off your lower garments. Are you not mindful of it? Purport. The girl Purvachiti was playing with a ball in her hand, and the ball seemed like nothing but another lotus flower captured by her lotus-like palm. Because of her movements, her hair was loose and the belt holding her cloth was giving way, as if the cunning wind were trying to make her naked. Yet she paid no attention to arranging her hair or fixing her dress. As Agnidra tried to see the girl's naked beauty, his eyes were very agitated by her movements. Text 15. O best among those performing austerities, where did you get this wonderful beauty that dismantles the austerities performed by others? Where have you learned this art? What austerity have you undergone to achieve this beauty, my dear friend? I desire that you join me to perform austerity and penance, for it may be that the creator of the universe, Lord Brahma, being pleased with me, has sent you to become my wife. Purport. Agnidra appreciated the wonderful beauty of Purvachiti. Indeed, he was surprised to see such exceptional beauty, which must have been the result of past austerities and penances. He therefore asked the girl whether she had achieved such beauty just to break the penances and austerities of others. He thought that Lord Brahma, the creator of the universe, might have been pleased with him and therefore might have sent her to become his wife. He requested Purvachiti to become his wife so that together they could perform austerities and penances in family life. In other words, a suitable wife helps her husband to perform penances and austerities in household life if both of them are on the same elevated platform of spiritual understanding. Without spiritual understanding, husband and wife cannot be equally situated. Lord Brahma, the creator of this universe, is interested in good progeny. Therefore, unless he is pleased, one cannot get a suitable wife. In fact, Lord Brahma is worshipped in marriage ceremonies. Even in India, even today, wedding invitations are still issued with a picture of Lord Brahma on the face of the card. Text 16. Lord Brahma, who is worshipped by the Brahmanas, has very mercifully given you to me, and that is why I have met you. I do not want to give up your company, for my mind and eyes are fixed upon you and cannot be drawn away. O woman with beautiful raised breasts, I am your follower. You may take me wherever you like, and your friends may also follow me. Purport. Now Agnidra frankly admits his weakness. He was attracted to Purvachiti, and therefore, before she could say, quote, but I have no business with you, end quote, he expressed his desire to be united with her. He was so attracted that he was ready to go anywhere, hell or heaven, in her company. When one is absorbed with lust and the influence of sex, one surrenders to the feet of a woman without reservations. Srila Madhvacharya remarks in this connection that one engages in joking and talking like a crazy person. One may say anything and everything, but his words will be meaningless. Text 17. Shukadev Goswami continued, Maharaj Agnidra, whose intelligence was like that of a demigod, knew the art of flattering women to win them by his side. He therefore pleaded that celestial girl with his lusty words and gained her favor. Purport. Since King Agnidra was a devotee, he actually had no attraction for material enjoyment, but because he wanted a wife for progeny and Lord Brahma had sent Purvachiti for this purpose, he expertly pleased her with flattering words. Women are attracted by a man's flattering words. One who is expert in this art of flattery is called Vidugdha. Text 18. Attracted by the intelligence, learning, youth, beauty, behavior, opulence, and magnanimity of Agnidra, the king of Jamadweep and master of all heroes, Purvachiti lived with him for many thousands of years and luxuriously enjoyed both worldly and heavenly happiness. Purport. By the grace of Lord Brahma, King Agnidra and the heavenly girl Purvachiti found their union quite suitable. Thus, they enjoyed worldly and heavenly happiness for many thousands of years. Text 19. In the womb of Purvachiti, Maharaj Agnidra, the best of kings, begot 9 sons, namely, named Napi, Kimpurusha, Harivarsha, Ilavrita, Ramyaka, Hiranmaya, Kuru, Bhardrashva, and Ketumala. Text 20. Purvachiti gave birth to these 9 sons, 1 each year, but after they grew up, she left them at home and again approached Lord Brahma to worship him. Purport. There are many instances in which Apsaras, heavenly angels, have descended to this earth by the order of a superior demigod like Lord Brahma or Lord Indra, have followed the demigod's order by marrying someone and giving birth to children, and have then returned to their celestial homes. For example, after Menaka, the celestial woman who had come to delude Vishvamitra Muni, gave birth to the child Shakuntala, she left both the child and her husband and returned to the heavenly planets. Purvachiti did not remain permanently with Maharaj Agnidra. After cooperating in his household affairs, she left Maharaj Agnidra and all 9 sons and returned to Brahma to worship him. Text 21. Because of drinking the breast milk of their mother, the 9 sons of Agnidra naturally had strong, well-built bodies. Their father gave them each a kingdom in different parts of Jamadweep. The kingdoms were named according to the names of the sons. Thus, the sons of Agnidra ruled the kingdoms they received from their father. Purport. The Acharyas have specifically mentioned that in this verse, the words Matu Agnu Grahat, quote, by the mercy of their mother, refers to the breast milk of their mother. In India, it is a common belief that if a baby is fed his mother's milk for at least 6 months, his body will be very strong. Besides that, it is mentioned herein that all the sons of Agnidra were endowed with the nature of their mother. Bhagavad Gita 140 also declares, Strishu Dutasu Varshneya Jayate Varna Shankara. When women are polluted, Varna Sankara, unqualified children, are generated, and when the Varna Sankara population increases, the entire world becomes hellish. Therefore, according to Manusmita, a woman needs a great deal of protection in order to remain pure and chaste so that her children can be fully engaged for the benefit of human society. Text 22. After Purvachiti's departure, King Agnidra, his lusty desires not at all satisfied, always thought of her. Therefore, in accordance with the Vedic injunctions, the king, after his death, was promoted to the same planet as his celestial wife. That planet, which is called Prithvi Loka, is where the Pitas, the forefathers, live in great delight. Purport. If one always thinks of something, he certainly gets a related body after death. Maharaj Agnidra was always thinking of Prithvi Loka, the place where his wife had returned. Therefore, after his death, he achieved that same planet, probably to live with her again. Bhagavad Gita also says, Yam yam vapi smaram bhavam, tajyantya de kalevaram, tam tam etaiva kunteya, sadatat bhavita. Quote, whatever state of being one remembers when he quits his body, that state he will attain without fail, end quote. Bhagavad Gita 8.6. We can naturally conclude that if we always think of Krishna or become fully Krishna conscious, we can be promoted to the planet Golok Vrindavan, where Krishna eternally lives. Text 23. After the departure of their father, the nine brothers married the nine daughters of Meru, named Merudevi, Pati Rupa, Ugra Damastri, Lata, Ramya, Shyama, Nari, Bhadra, and Devaviti. Thus end the Bhaktivedanta purports of the fifth canto, second chapter of the Srimad Bhagavatam, entitled The Activities of Maharaj Agnidra.